Hello, my name is Daniel Rosen, and I'm a pathologist at Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, Texas, and today we're going to talk about adrenal pathology. The anatomy of the adrenal gland is a retroperitoneal structure containing its own subcompartment in the gyrotes fascia, usually measures 5 by 3 by 1 cm. The adrenal gland has a cortex that comes from the mesoderm, and the medulla from the neuroectoderm. Histologic sections of the adrenal gland will show that the cortex is composed of the zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, and zona reticularis, and the medulla is composed by chromaffin cells. The zona glomerulosa secretes aldosterone, fasciculata cortisol, and reticularis mainly the sex hormone androgen, and chromaffin cells epinephrine and norepinephrine. We're going to talk a little bit about the metabolic syndromes. First, we're going to discuss the adrenal insufficiency or Addison syndrome, which is produced by a decrease of mineralo and glucocorticoids. There's a primary and secondary form of adrenal insufficiency. Primary is mainly by antibodies against the adrenal gland, and the secondary caused by pituitary disease, for example, Sheehan syndrome. In the sections of the primary, in a case of a primary adrenal insufficiency, you will see that there's cortical destruction, marked cortical atrophy, and residual cells show hypertrophic changes due to the ACTH effect, while in the secondary there's all normal findings. It's important to remember that the increased ACTH to the negative feedback loop in the primary adrenal insufficiency will cause hyperpigmentation in the patient, whereas the lack of ACTH will cause no hyperpigmentation. The next metabolic syndrome is the adrenal hyperfunction. We have the Cushing syndrome, which is caused by excess cortisol, and Cone syndrome by hyperaldosteronism. The Cushing syndrome can be either caused by adrenal or extra-adrenal causes, while the Cone syndrome can be primary, secondary, or tertiary. Adrenal Cushing syndrome can be caused by adrenal hyperplasia, adenomas, and rarely carcinomas, and extra-adrenal causes by pituitary adenomas or exogenous cortisol-producing tumors. Also, the Cone syndrome or hyperaldosteronism can be caused by adenomas and carcinomas, which is exceedingly rare. And Cone syndrome secondary causes is produced by the decrease of blood flow in the renal artery or adenomatous disorders such as chronic heart failure. A tertiary form of hyperaldosteronism or Bartter syndrome is produced by the hyperplasia of the juxtaglomerular cell apparatus. We're going to discuss four main lesions of the adrenal gland. Benign lesions, which are the adenoma, the myelolipoma, pheochromocytoma, and ganglioneuromas. First, the cortical adenomas are benign neoplasms arising from the adrenal cortical cells, may or may not be functional. Grossly, you'll see that these lesions are composed by a well-circumscribed tumor growth. They are usually unilateral and solitary. The ipsilateral adrenal gland may show areas of ipsilateral atrophy. Sections will show that the cortical adenoma are composed by large cells with distinct cell borders, foamy cytoplasm, and there's nuclear variation. Also remember that there's some histologic variants such as the oncocytic variant and myxoid variant. Necrosis and ectopia can be seen in kids. The adenomas in Cushing are usually yellow and brown or black, also well circumscribed, and will resemble the reticularis because it produces cortisol. Also, there's a mixture of clear and pink cells. Here you see the pink cells and some more clear cells full of fat. Fat and myeloid metaplasia is common. The adenomas in the Cone syndrome usually are small, less than 2 centimeters in size, with a yellow cut surface. Sections will show that these cells are similar to a granulosa or fasciculata. Since patients are treated with spironolactone because of the hypertension, it's not uncommon to see these spironolactone bodies, which are eosinophilic intracytoplasmic inclusions. cortical adenomas, if you need to do immunostains, you'll find that they are positive for inhibin, melanin, MALT1, steroidogenic factor 1, and calretinin. They may or may not be positive for synaptophysin, and they're usually negative for vimentin, although some rare cases were reported as positive. Important fact is that there are no subtentacular cells positive for S100. The incidentalomas are lesions that are less than 1 cm discovered on the exam for another cause that is non-adrenal in the absence of signs or symptoms of adrenal disorder. They represent 0.5 to 5% of abdominal CTs that may show abnormal adrenal glands, and 85% are non-functional and benign. Myelolipomas are composed of mature adipose tissue, like you see here, and hematopoietic islands, which can be very prominent, such as in this case. You will see erythroid precursors, myeloid precursors, and also occasional megakaryocytes. Pheochromocytoma is another benign tumor composed of adrenal medullary chromaffin cells, most commonly in young adults, 40 to 50s, and 10% can be seen in kids. 10% are extra-adrenal, or also called paragangliomas, 10% familial, and 10% bilateral. Occasionally, they are associated with melanomas, adrenal cortical tumors, and paragangliomas. Also, familial syndromes are associated with pheochromocytomas, such as MEN, Sturge-Weber, Bonnipel-Lindau, and neurofibromatosis type 1, von Recklinghausen. The cross sections will show that this is a well encapsulated gray pink to tan mass. Sections show the proliferation of cords, nest, or these cell valen, which are these groups of cells with a delicate fibrovascular septum. High power will show that these cells have what is called the salt and pepper chromatin, or stippled chromatin. Immunostains will show that these tumor cells are positive for chromogranin, synaptophysin, neurofilament, and the S100 will show these spindle subtentacular cells. They are negative for cytokeratins and vimentin. The pheochromocytoma S100 stain here is to highlight these spindle subtentacular cells. Also, pheochromocytomas can progress into a malignancy, and the most reliable criteria is the presence of metastasis. Of course, this is rare, and if metastasis occur, they go to the lymph nodes, liver, lung, and bone. There's also a pheochromocytoma of the adrenal gland scale score, which assign a series of points. 1 point if there's vascular invasion, capsular invasion, or profound nuclear pleomorphism, atypia, and hyperchromasia. And 2 points if there's invasion of periadrenal adipose tissue, large nest or diffuse growth, focal confluent necrosis, high cellularity, tumor cell spindling, cellular monotony, or 4+ mitotic figures per more than 4 mitotic figures per 10 hyperbaric fields, and atypical mitotic figures. If these lesions add up more than 4 points, there's potential for malignancy. The next benign lesion is ganglioneuroma, which arises in the adrenal medulla and ganglia. It's common in kids and young adults and may evolve to malignant peripheral nerve tumors. Histologically, you'll see that the stroma resembles a neurofibroma with these spindle cells with embedded in a collagenous matrix. And here are these thin wavy spindle cells, or Schwann type cells. Occasionally, you'll see in the ganglioneuroma these ganglion cells, which may have mild to moderate atypia. Also remember that these lesions may contain lymphocytic infiltrates that may be confused with neuroblasts. The ganglioneuroma is positive for S100 in the stroma and neurofilament, chromogranin, and NSC in ganglion cells. Malignant adrenal tumors, we will discuss two of them, adrenal cortical carcinoma and ganglioneuroblastoma. The adrenal cortical carcinoma is most common in the 40s and 50s and is associated with Cushing syndrome with a survival of 14 months. These are large cortical masses, usually invading the adjacent structures with large areas of necrosis. And sections will show a poorly differentiated neoplasm with a solid growth pattern and a mixture of lipid-laden cells and lipid-depleted cells. Here you see the lipid-laden cells adjacent with lipid-depleted cells. High power, you see that there is also more than 5 mitotic figures per 50 high power fields. And here also highlights the presence of the lipid-laden and lipid-depleted cells. There's high nuclear grade, and it's not uncommon to see necrosis, lymphovascular invasion, and capsular invasion. If you decide to do immunostains, you'll find that these cells are positive for bimentin, MELAN-A, and MALT1, and may or may not be positive for synaptophysin, neurofilament, neuron-specific enolase, calretinin, HEPAR1, and S100, and CAM5.2. They're negative for cytokeratin 7, 20, EMA, CEA, and B72.3 and chromogranin. The neuroblastoma or stroma poor neuroblastoma is most common in kids less than 8 years old. It's also, there's an increased risk in fetal alcohol syndrome and Edantoin syndrome. Sections will show that these tumors are composed of round blue cells. Not uncommon to see human right pseudorosettes, which are this ring of neuroblasts with a center of fibrillary material, and also individual cells that are separated by this fibrillary eosinophilic matrix. The neuroblastoma or stroma poor neuroblastoma can have good and bad prognostic signs. The good prognostic signs are the low stage, the at presentation, young age, less than 1 year old, fibril histology, and aneuploid tumors, less than 3 enmic copies per cell, and extra adrenal locations. Poor prognostic signs are high stage and presentation, older age, and fibril histology, diploid tumors, more than 10 enmic copies per cell, and adrenal location. The ganglioneuroblastoma, also called stroma-rich neuroblastoma, is usually seen in kids less than 10 years old, but also can happen in adults. This is a mixed population of ganglioneuroma and neuroblastoma, where you can see more differentiated and poorly differentiated areas of neuroblast and ganglion cells. So with this, I conclude adrenal gland tumors. Thank you so much for your attention.